The author has also asked me to mention that he has hearing loss and speaking difficulties. So he's going to try his best to slow down and be more clear during his talk. So please cooperate with him. And you can also look at the caption on the screen.
Thank you, Uta. Let me start with the motivation behind the project. Like, why are we trying to do that? Oceans have always, I've always loved oceans since my childhood, and I always wanted to explore it using scuba diving. I always loved oceans since my childhood, and I always wanted to explore it using scuba diving. But I couldn't do it because I lived in a landlocked region in India, far away from the large bodies of water. And so when I arrived through MIT, the very first thing I did was to sign up for a scuba diving course. And it was a beautiful experience, like being able to like surround by 3D water and, you know, aquatic plants and marine life and stuff. It was just beautiful. But I also wish that I could have given that experience back to friends and family at home and to all those people who cannot scuba dive due to medical or circumstantial reasons. And that's why I came up with this idea of Amphibian. So Amphibian is a virtual reality scuba diving simulator that allows people to experience immersive scuba diving on land. The user rests on a spring torso that promotes weightlessness and is attached to the elastic band. Excuse me, sorry. Yeah, so the user rests on a spring torso that promotes weightlessness and it attached to the elastic band that simulates gradual motion. The ocean scene and the sound is delineated by the Oculus Rift application and the noise-canceling headphone. Now, Amphibian is different from other simulators out there because apart from visual and auditory sensation, the Amphibian simulates a large variety of sensations out there, like anesthesia, temperature, buoyancy, etc. So I'm sure you're really excited to learn more about the system design, but just give me a few minutes to explain you about the related work to help better situate my work out there. So three categories. One is the scuba PC game, then the cave-like simulation system, and third is the immersive pool simulation. So let's start with the cave-like scuba PC game. There are many games out there that simulate maritime environment. Now, these games usually start with a player that moves through the interactive visual in the form of rocks or marine life or, you know, other related stuff. To make things more immersive, Frolic and Takala et al. Came up with a cave-like simulation system where they enclosed the user in a pool of water. Or a tank of water and project the 3D images of the aquatic world onto the walls of the room or the walls of the tank. Now, these systems obviously are more immersive because, well, this is literal immersion, but the user would get wet. But in Amphibian, we generate the feeling of being immersive in water on land. Hold on. So we believe our strongest contribution is the simulation of unusual sensations like buoyancy, temperature, breath control, and more, which have not been significantly explored in other relative simulators out there. So let me just explain about the system design. You know, underwater is a very inhospitable environment, and there's so much more to the underwater world than the real world out there. For example, underwater, our sense of vision is blurred. We cannot, like, experience poor contrast underwater, and we experience limited visual range. Also, our sense of sound is different underwater because, like, water causes sound to travel 5 times faster in underwater, and that's why we're not able to hear sound clearly. Similarly, our sense of sound is also, like, I'm sorry. Similarly, we cannot hear things, cannot smell things underwater, and we avoid tasting things underwater. And so that's why I think there's so much more to the underwater world than just visual and auditory sensation. We built our simulator to include 6 different sensations. And those are the sensations of kinesthesia, breath, temperature, visual and audio, and track. Now let's start with the sense of kinesthesia. Now this part is inspired from my own personal experience with scuba diving and through other relative simulators out there. For example, Bodley or swimming across the Pacific. So we simulated two forces that are exerted by water on the human body. One is the buoyancy force, and the other is the drag force. To simulate buoyancy force, we placed the user on the spring torso, as you just saw. And to simulate the drag force, we attached the user to the elastic band to simulate gradual motion. And the next is the breath. So let me tell you about this breath a little bit. So the breathing is a very, very important concept in diving. It's like when the user, when I dive and I'm in the water and I encounter an obstacle in my path of travel, I would normally inhale to move a little bit up, then cross the obstacle, and then exhale to move down. So it's a beautiful feeling underwater when you're diving, using breathing to have buoyancy control. And in order to simulate that, we used a gas sensor that was attached to the mouthpiece of the user, so that when the user inhaled and exhaled, the amount of air that moved in and out of the user was measured using the gas sensor. We also have an inflatable cushion that was placed on the spring torso of the user. And so when the user inhaled and exhaled, the spring torso was inflated with the air and vacuum pump that moving slowly, moving up and down when the user inhaled and exhaled. And you know, when I dive, when I go down, the water temperature decreases. In order to simulate the change in water temperature, we use the Peltier module that we attach on the wrist of the user to simulate temperature changes as the user moves up and down with the depth in the Oculus Rift application. For the audio visual, the user swam in a rocky area underwater. And you know, we've been through a bunch of fish and aquatic life and plants and all that to make it all look interesting. What was particularly significant was the sound of the user's breath exhalation when the user dives in the water. And this sound simulation is very important for me because like I have a hearing loss. And when I dive, I'm not able to hear those sounds at all. But using Amphibian, I can put on my hearing gauge and then put on the Oculus, put on the head-mounted display, and I'm able to hear the whale song and the sound of the user's breath exhalation and something like that. So it's a very important for me who's hard of hearing and for other people who are divers or non-divers, etc. And this is a tactile simulation. So when the user grabs an object, like an underwater object, like a rock or a crab underwater, we provide a physical feedback. Now this two-way interaction between the user and the aquatic environment has not been explored before in other VR diving simulators. And in order to simulate that, we use a silicone ball that was attached close to the glove of the user. So when the user grabs the underwater object, such as a rock or a crab, the glove detected the grasping gesture and the ball inflated, thus providing the physical sensation back to the user. Now let's look at the video on how this works. You know, this is particularly interesting because, you know, my advisor, Chris here. So like my advisor Chris here, he sort of tried it. And he tried to grab a crab underwater and the ball inflated. And he was like, ooh, yeah, now it's good. And so we implemented all these sensations to give the user the highest level of presence of being underwater in an terrestrial environment. So moving on to the evaluation part. So we tried our system with about 12 experienced divers because we wanted to compare the system to the real-life scuba diving. And the study procedure lasted for about 45 minutes on an average and contained three steps, which is the system experience, where the user tried the system, the open-ended questionnaire, where we took the feedback on the general application of the system, and like two questionnaires, one on immersion and the other on present. You know, this part is a little geared towards people who are more familiar with the immersion and present concept than we are, but like just to give you a little detail, we use Slater's definition from 1997. So immersion is the system property, the correctness of the technology that are employed in it. And present, on the other hand, is the user's response to an immersive system and is related to the sense of being in a virtual environment. And it's not hard to see that presence here is an increasing function of immersion. Because let's say, for example, if there is a multimodal system, that is obviously an immersive system, but it will also increase the user's sense of being in a virtual environment. So that's why like immersion is a presence is a function of immersion. And so, as I said before, we use two questionnaires, one on immersion and the other on presence. For immersion, we use the standard version, for immersion, we use the modified version of the Whitmer-Singer questionnaire for our purposes. And for present, we use the standard I-group presence questionnaire. So we divided the results of our study into three questions. So first is like how present were the users in our system? Second is how immersive was our system? And the third is how did immersion affect present with respect to our system? Because present is an increasing function of immersion. Let's look at the result. The overall value of present was found out to be 4.96 out of 7. We will come into details about this in a bit. But let's just look at the technology evaluation, which is the immersion result. I wish to tell you here that this part is very brief in the talk that I'm presenting, but if you look at the paper, we have a much more detailed evaluation or numerical analysis of all that we did in the simulation. So in brief, breathing was the most realistic part of the simulator. The users really appreciated being able to move up and down slowly with the breathing. This quote from P7, who are 110 dives, also showed this. Participants appreciated the graphics and the audio of the simulation. For kinesthesia, the leg movement was found to be realistic, but for the hand movement, it was not the usual way the divers move in the water. So kinesthesia was rated low by the participant. Ball grabbing had mixed reactions, and temperature was not noticed by most people because they were busy exploring the underwater environment. Now let's look at how the immersion part affected the present with respect to our system. So in order to do that, we need to go into the details of the presence questionnaire, which gives us three loaded factors, which are the spatial presence, which are environment, and the realness. Now, the spatial presence here is the sense of acting in the real environment as opposed to operating something from outside. Involvement is the attention given to the real and the virtual environment, while realness is the comparison of the real life and the virtual environment. It's not hard to see that the average of all of these three values contributed to the 4.96 value of the presence. If you look over here, there is one more result. If you see here, the value of spatial presence and involvement were rated to be high, while the realness were rated to be low. Which means that if you look at it, we can infer that though the participants were present and engaged in our simulator, they did not behave as if they were scuba diving for real. Or in other words, their action in the simulator were not natural. And now this is easy to see from the immersion results too, because as you can look here, the people liked the graphics and the audio part of the simulator, which means that they were present and engaged, but the movement part was rated low, which means that their actions were not natural. So that's how the immersion effect is present with respect to our system. In conclusion, the strongest contribution of a VR diving simulator is the simulation of unvisual sensations like breathing, temperature, buoyancy control, and more. In fact, the user study with 12 experienced divers demonstrated that while some characteristics of the system were realistic, the implementation of other elements like the kinesthesia could be trained for higher immersion in the future. Future work. Let me tell you this about a bit. So Misha here, Misha, which is the co-author of a paper, and she actually mentioned in the supplementary video of Amphibian that she's afraid of water. And so when I used to come back from diving, I used to tell her that, you know, it was awesome, it was so cool, and she couldn't do it. But now, with Amphibian, she can dive and experience all the wonderful ocean life in a terrestrial convenient setting. So similarly, this system can be used by other people who are afraid of water, who cannot dive due to medical or circumstantial reasons. And so the other applications, which are like using it for training or for like informing people about ocean damage done by divers. So the general insight. And I wish to tell you here that though our simulator was mostly suited to simulate a very specific activity of scuba diving, some of our results have wider applicability across general VR diving simulators. For example, for building a simulator, we learned that it's not necessary to replicate every single sensation. For an example, in our simulator, we had a temperature sensation that is very important for real-life diving, but it was not appreciated well in the simulator. The people usually ignored it. So in fact, sometimes a literal translation of the physical action does not translate over well into a VR world. An example of this is that in the breathing simulation, we had to speed up the up and down movement of the user a bit because in real life it is a bit too slow. So in final conclusion, as designers, we can be creative while also keeping the system usability and the user comfort aspect in mind. So go dive, but if you can do it, then we have the next best thing here. Thank you very much.
We have time for a couple of questions. Is there any questions from the
audience? One moment. When we ask the question, I'm going to look at the caption screen because I have hearing loss. And so, like, I don't mind if I'm not looking at you when we're asking questions. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah.
Hello, Roshan from KU University. Very nice work. And
Okay.
Hi. I was just wondering because one of the things you experience when you dive is the pressure sensation, especially in your ears. And sometimes we go through these like rituals, like closing the nose and breathing out and things like that. So I was wondering if that kind of rituals or like actions would help them. Help with the immersion more, or like, did they mention anything like that with the experienced divers? Yeah.
So, thank you. This is actually a very good point. We did think about like using pressure sensation for like simulating in our amphibian, but one of our design goals was to make the simulator convenient for people, to make it people who are even have problems with the lungs and etc. can also dive with the simulator. And in order to make it more accessible, more convenient, we didn't do the pressure simulation as such. But yeah, it's a very, very important concept for diving. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay, any question?
Hi, Jan from Ulm University. Really cool work. I was wondering, did you guys or did any of your participants experience some form of simulator sickness since you have a motion in there that you have visually but not physically experienced it?
So that's also a good point, because in Oculus Rift, some of the Oculus Rift studies have shown that users experience a little bit of motion sickness when they try that. And we were also like hypothesizing that it would happen with our simulator, but with the 12 experienced divers who did the study, we did not notice it. And probably because like they are used to diving and moving in the 3D space, so maybe that's one of the reasons they're not experiencing motion sickness.
Thanks.
All right. Okay, thanks for speakers.